Hey guys, it's Karen from Toronto here, and today we're joined by Toronto's amazing real estate and family lawyer, Jazz Dillon.
Hi Karen, how are you? Nice to be here with you again.
Great to have you back again. And today's topic is on holdbacks. And before we share a recent scenario where a holdback was used, I think it would be helpful to mention what a holdback is. Jazz, would you like to explain what's a holdback?
Yeah, absolutely. So a holdback is a certain dollar amount in a real estate transaction that's held back, and it's agreed upon between the buyer's lawyer and the seller's lawyer. So some common types of holdbacks might occur if there's any repairs or a replacement needed into the home, or if there's other deficiencies that the buyer didn't get a chance to inspect, and then you know, after closing, they see something that was supposed to be inspected but wasn't. So those are usually common ones. In the issue of condos, sometimes property managers don't know what the special assessment is. So there could be a holdback depending on what comes out of the special assessment or when the status certificate is, you know, received. It's a certain dollar amount that's held back, essentially.
Okay, great. Now that we understand what a holdback is, I'll share some background information on a real estate transaction that recently closed and involved a holdback. So one of the associates on our team was working with a purchaser, and the purchaser bought a home here in Toronto. When they first saw the house for sale, the owner still had all of their furniture and belongings in the property. So in this case, when the purchaser saw the closets, they were full of clothing and empty suitcases. Everything seemed fine, they loved the house and proceeded to submit an offer. The offer was accepted and all the conditions were eventually fulfilled. So typically, a purchaser is allowed to visit the house again before they officially receive the keys on closing. And what the purchasers noticed was a substantial amount of mold in one of the bedroom walk-in closets. The purchasers did not see the mold during their first visit because the mold was hidden by all of the clothing and empty suitcases. Since mold poses a health issue, the purchasers asked the owners to remedy the mold in the closet, and unfortunately, the owners refused to pay for the mold removal. They insisted that the deal was already firm and that it was the purchaser's responsibility. In this case, the purchaser spoke to their lawyer, and their lawyer managed to arrange a holdback of $3,500, which would be used by the purchaser to remedy the issue. Now, I imagine most transactions involving a holdback would require the consent of both parties involved. In this case, only one party was consenting since the homeowners were not willing to remedy the mold issue and they were not agreeing to a holdback of funds. In cases like this, where a homeowner is not willing to remedy issues with the property and they're not agreeing to a holdback of funds to pay for these issues, if the purchasers are adamant that certain issues are fixed in order to close, could the seller's lawyer agree to a holdback without the consent of their clients?
Yeah, so thank you for that scenario. I guess that's very unfortunate about the mold issue. But as you know, that inspections, you know, buyers buy without having any inspections done, and these certain areas, you know, deficiencies do come up. The proper way of going about holdbacks, if an issue like this arises, is that both lawyers should actually get consent and approval from their clients and let them know what that holdback is, how much it is, why it's being held back, and that full knowledge should be made aware to both vendor and the purchaser. So I don't have particulars about this case that you're talking about and how one lawyer was just able to hold back unilaterally. It's better to have both lawyers agree and their clients agree on it. That's the proper way of going about it. Now, your question in regards to if they can do that, no, it's not. It's improper, like I said. To hold back. So where you have a situation where one party is refusing to the hold back, what can happen is the buyers would close with protest and making a, you know, an issue in letting the vendor know that, okay, we're going to close, but we know that this issue is on the table. And if you're not agreeing to a hold back, then what they can do, the buyers, is they can sue the vendor for the abatement of the purchase price. So they could seek a court order for a reduction in the purchase price. And that would be their kind of remedy if they can't get the hold back.
I see. Okay. Yeah. So based on this information, once a real estate transaction is firm, is it correct to say that a purchaser is not able to use a holdback as a means of recourse to remedy any issues before closing?
Right. Right. Exactly. Yeah.
All right. So in cases where a holdback is in place, how quickly will a purchaser receive the funds from the holdback?
So I think it varies depending on residential or commercial transaction. But so for residential transactions, I would say that anywhere between 30 to 60 days is a good timeline of when that holdback can be released. That is in line with when lenders would like their final report, usually within 60 days of closing. So I know at my office, we follow that procedure. Usually clients will get their holdback within 60 days of closing.
Okay, awesome. Thank you so much, Jazz, for sharing your legal knowledge and expertise.
Absolutely. It's always a pleasure to meet with you and do these meetings with you.
So if anyone is looking for a great real estate lawyer or family lawyer in Toronto, give Jazz a call. And in the meantime, if you're thinking of buying or selling a property, give us a call.